One of the more arcane problems in finance is lease versus purchase. It's not difficult, but it can be a little tricky. It starts with an initial investment at time zero. The present value of that is typically 1-to-1, notwithstanding some possibilities of investment tax credits, which we will forego here. Then there's depreciation, which you never have with a lease. And recall that it's actually a deferred cash payment and is recognized at the time the asset is used. We're going to use straight-line depreciation here for merely academic purposes, noting that there have been many variants in terms of the IRS rules, double declining balance, some of the year's digits, acres 1, acres 2, the accelerated cost recovery system. But here, let's make it straight line because it makes the computations and the illustrations easier. And then there's salvage value. And contrary to what you think, there is no tax consequence, at least not conjectured at the time of purchase. It may be after the fact. Then there's the lease. And it's a negative payment, but after tax, so you get a tax credit. And in that sense, it's like the depreciation on the purchase, in that both get a tax savings. So to recapitulate, the initial outlay is 1-for-1, usually no tax consequences. The depreciation, you're only recognizing the tax savings, the tax shield. It's a positive cash flow. It's the tax rate times the depreciation recognized. And then you have the salvage value at, say, terminal time period T, where usually you do not have any tax consequences. And if they are, they're not conjectured at the time of purchase. Then there's the lease. That's after tax, a negative cash flow. So in terms of your computations, that also is uniquely different in that it's usually at the beginning of the period, say 0 through T minus 1, whereas if we're using, say, straight-line depreciation for academic purposes here, it would be at the end of the period, say 1 through T. That would also be the case had we included revenues, which we're not, because this might be a mandatory project. In the case of those end-of-the-year payments, we'd be using an annuity, 1 through time period T. At the beginning of the period payments, we would be using an annuity, 0 through T minus 1. While later we're going to show this as an Excel presentation, we also note that these can be done manually, using tables, using formulas, and in this case, let's see, the formula for any single sum, which I'm going to call a single sum, would apply to the salvage value, and it, of course, is the reciprocal of the future value. The discount rate, we're going to make that after tax. That's, again, times 1 minus the tax rate of the, say, interest rate. And that will be for the loan, having made a purchase. And more interestingly, we can even use that in the case of a lease, because that's the cost we're avoiding by not purchasing. Then we have an annuity. And, of course, again, we can use Excel, calculators, tables. But the mnemonic trick here is to recognize an annuity is a perpetuity minus a delayed present value of the perpetuity not received. You can see it in the formula. Reciprocal of the discount rate is the perpetuity minus the portion we didn't receive, which of course would be the present value at time period T. The annuity for a beginning of the period on the last line is the end of the period annuity times one period of sooner present value. Or a trick is you go up one row on the annuity table into the period and add number 1 to it, and you'll get the same factor. And of course, no presentation would be complete without a numeric example. Let's say we have a purchase. It costs us $850,000. No, we're not going to have any tax credits or any of that confounded stuff. Let's say we expect $50,000 in salvage value in the ninth year. I do this so it makes the Excel table real nice and clean and pretty and maybe realistic. We're going to have eight-year life. We're going to have the same depreciation of the difference between the investment and the salvage value. That's 800 grand across 8 years will be 100 grand. And, well, we're going to have a lease across 8 years. It's going to cost us 125 grand. Noting again that the payments are at the beginning of the period. The interest rate will be 5%. The tax bracket will be 20%. Before going into greater detail, let's take a big picture look at this and note, the lease costs a grand total of $1 million across 8 years. The purchase cost $850,000. It turns out that's kind of misleading and is really a nice transition to look at this in greater detail. Let's now first convert these to after-tax payments. The initial investment stays at $850,000. The salvage value, again, we don't preview any kind of gains or losses. That only occurs after the fact. But now notice the depreciation yields a positive tax savings of 20 grand a year for years 1 through 8. The lease after tax is now a net 100 grand for the 8 years, but starting in period 0, and ending at the end of period 7. Well, again, we're going to use an after-tax interest rate, which is now 4% from the 20% tax rate on the 5% interest charge. Again, the time period covered will be 8 years, end and beginning of the periods for the depreciation and lease. And just to make things convenient, let's take the salvage value in the ninth year. I've moved the after-tax cash flows to the left here so I can create some room to place the present values on the now vacant right-hand column. Of course, we'll see the entire Michigas on the Excel program at the end. Recapitulating, we have a net $850 going out right at the beginning. Salvage value is $50 in the ninth year. We have depreciation savings of $20 coming in years 1 through 8. And a net cost of the lease of 100 going out, time periods 0 through 7. And we're using a discount rate of 4%. That's the after-tax rate of the 5% loan, which applies even to the lease because we're avoiding taking the loan. Now let's do the present values. Well, the initial investment times 0, no tax consequences normally, unchanged, minus 850. Salvage value, year 9, make it convenient. Well, that 50 now has a present value of 35,129, and we see the factor down there, 0.7026. For the depreciation into the period for the 20 grand, saving us, well, the 8 years, the present value into the period factor, 6.7327. For the lease, after tax cash flows, beginning of the period, minus 100 each year, period 0 through 7. Well, the annuity factor is 7.0020, noting that that's the former end-of-the-period annuity factor increased by 4%, or a trick, go up one row on the end-of-the-period table, if you have one, and add the number 1, you'd get the same factor of 7.0 and some change. Well, let's see, that turns out, in case of the lease, to be some 700 grand and 205 bucks. The net present value for the purchase minus the initial investment plus the salvage value plus the tax savings is minus 680 and some 216. Notice how close they are, and the lease is still a little bit more expensive, and that's traditionally the case. Why? Leases avoid business risk, style risk, obsolescence risk, and even something called interest rate risk, and many times people would pay a premium for that. Now, you may say, wait a minute, Dr. Chucky. You can call me that if you want. What about the loan computation? Turns out, if you're using the loan as a basis for the marginal cost after tax, it should be a wash, and you can avoid it because the net present value is zero. Here, look. Let's say we paid $50,000 down. Let's say we're purchasing it. Net $800,000, 5%. But remember, it's 4% after tax because we're in the 20% tax bracket. So in time period zero, we receive $800 from the bank. I'm doing these in thousands. After tax, well, that's still $800,000. And the present value of that is still $800,000. And then in time periods 1 through 8, we're going to pay 5% on the $800,000. That's $40,000. But remember, after tax, we're saving 20%. So our net outflow is $32,000 each year into the period. Then we got to pay back the balance, that's $800,000, and we're going to use a single sum figure there, again, after tax at 4%, and you figure out the present values, the factors are showing, add it all up, net present value, zero. Yes, that's right. Present value of any loan at its own self-same after-tax discount rate is zero. Not only makes things easier, faster, but think of it, you'd be double counting the interest. Well, as promised, here's the Excel spreadsheet version. And we set the years up so we can calculate it. I've also calculated the annuity table at the bottom again. 5% interest rate, but after tax of 20%, it's really 4%. We got the cash flows there in column C. And then we take the present values in column D. And then there's the lease payments after tax in column E, and the present value of those in column F. And, well, on line 16 is the net present value, and the calculated amounts confirm them. And here, of course, is a graph. We have the lease and the purchase shown. I've thrown in a loan for good measure. Traditionally, leases have less interest rate risk, hence the shallower nature of it. Remember, they offset the cash flows associated with revenues. The purchase, on the other hand, has nothing but positive cash flows, which go the same direction as revenues. And notice the cross points on the axis are the internal rates of return. I've added a gray line to show where you would be making the analysis at the after-tax cost of the loan, the internal rate of return of the loan, if you will, noting that this graph is for other numbers from other examples, and moreover, it includes revenue figures, which we did not, which, of course, is no big deal if you think about it, or maybe is with Dr. C Invests.